Yeah, man. Looking back, I seemed a little salty in the Dark Willow guide, eh? What's weird is that, spoiler alert, I secretly love Pangolier. It's almost as if Dark Willow is both liked by most Dota fans and hated by me because she's overpowered, and Pangolier the reverse because he's very much not. You could probably argue he's underpowered, which in itself is an amazing achievement for a hero added to Dota 2. Centaur had like a 60% win rate, Earth Spirit, Oracle. Even Oracle had an above 50% win rate. Literally nobody knew what his spells even did, and he's still demolished because, mostly, in fact, exclusively because of his ultimate that had a 20-second cooldown and made you invisible. But the point is, he was rightly nerfed into a position of relative balance. But Pango started off nerfed. I only see buffs in his future. But does that mean he's bad right now? In my opinion, no. He just takes a little actual getting used to. You'd be hard-pressed to win your first Pango game like you can do with Dark Willow. And for a hero that can be good, knowing that he's going to get buffed in the future is really good information. Board the MMR train now, boys. Let's learn the only way to play Pango. Whoa, Oh god, okay. So, correct me if I'm wrong, but the last time this segment appeared at the start of the video was years ago in my Weaver guide, where I suggested phase boots Aghs. And back then I had to put this section here before the rest because, specifically, a build that absurdly backwards required us to collaboratively rethink the entire structure of Weaver's playstyle. But I'm sure that's just a coincidence. It's clearly a mistake in writing the script that I've put this section here, right? Right? Let's find out. Let's do something a little unique with this guide, right? What does Valve think Pango should go? And I'm not talking about their default guide or anything, I'm talking specifically about what items did Valve get Pangolier's voice actor to record a line for? Wow, look at them all, there's a lot in there. No support items, no wards or anything, so Valve seems to think he's a core. I'm with them so far. It seems the order on screen is actually evidence towards preference. The ones listed first have titles like Pangolin item 1, and the last one is like number 37. So what's listed first? Okay, it's Aghs. It's Aghs three times. Does Pango have an Aghs upgrade? He doesn't, right? Remember, they get the voice actor once, predict what items he should record for, and then send them on his way. I don't know, guys. You think Pango is getting an Aghs upgrade soon? I think it might happen. But enough stalling, here's my build. Start off simple enough, I think Pango's a pretty good offlaner. He's got good durability, good kill potential, good escapes, and a way of securing last hits. So going offlane, start with ample tangos, a stout shield, any leftover cash, you can sort of build towards wand, maybe a quelling blade. Generally, you'd order boots of speed, wand, and ring of health in accordance to what you'd need first, but you'd get all three. Ring on a hard lane, wand on a spell spammy lane, boots when you like killing, and then we start veering from the norm really fast. There's still a modicum of reason, but boots of choice are arcane boots, and to prove my point, look at the absolutely tipped scale of win rates between Pango's two level 10 talents, a whopping 5.6, one of the highest talent differentials in the game, for the two mana regen. Pango needs mana, Pango loses when he ignores how much he needs mana, Pango wins when he gets mana. Although, ironically, because of the arcane boots pickup, we skip the mathematically better level 10 talent in favor of instead the movement speed. But it's best not to look into that too much. Next, chronologically, we'd go Javelin, and what a change, right? Before 707, who would ever think of getting a raw Javelin? I bet you didn't even know it actually had a passive ability, because who would? Literally, it just clutters your item slots, right? I've had Basher games where the Javelin stayed on Courier until it became Basher, and now we get it all by itself. We can even skip Basher completely in Pango game, sometimes. To those who don't know, it now gives a 25% chance to pierce evasion and also deal 100 bonus magical damage, and yes, for some reason, these stack completely. In fact, the first iteration of this Pango guide was 5 of these, because if you were lucky, you could proc all 5 on one auto attack, and it would be 500 extra magical damage. But we've progressed in this item build. Maybe for the worse. This basically helps us one-shot a creep wave with Swashbuckle, which we'll be spamming a lot with our Arcane Boots mana. Javelin is our farming item, and that won't not sound weird to me for a very, very long time. We continue on our descent into madness with Yules. I mean, why not? Move speed, mana regen, all great stats. But nah, I'm kidding, I'm not that crazy. With Yules, you can have a guaranteed 6 second, 1400 damage Rolling Thunder. But it's too early for that trump card yet. Yules also helps us a lot with this overarching theme of constant self-immunity, while also having extreme disabling capabilities that Pango pretty much builds his kit around. And that's it for core. Anything else is just an extension of these conceptual ideas we've started to form with this build. Ring of Health began as a necessary health regen item because nothing else really made sense. For efficiency, this can and should become anything from Lincoln's to Lotus Orb to Vanguard into Abyssal Blade. Lincoln's being a suggested item for the sort of hero that Pango is, you know? In and out, like a Storm or a Weaver, and both of them get it. BKB's overkill, you're not in danger for extended periods of what would facilitate needing something like that. Lotus Orb would act in sort of the same way. Even the new item Aeon Disc would be good, although getting into what Aeon Disc even is can't really be done offhand in a Pangolier guide. I feel like that item needs a guide all of its own. And then, to really seal the deal, Radiance. We're lacking damage outside of Rolling Thunder, but we have this constant sustain, right? While also running around the outskirts of fights. So I can't actually think of a better damage item than Radiance for Pango. And yes, that includes Diffusal Blade. I'm not blind to trends. In reality, it's just a case of keeping a balance towards damage and defense. You're not dying at all, but you're struggling to kill them in exchange? Yeah, maybe don't get that Crimson Guard. Maybe get a Rapier. You know, stuff like that. And if you care to notice, every single one of those items was listed before Diffusal Blade in the voice actor lines. It's just an observation. And of course, future-proof your builds. Get Ags, and then when everyone's doing it next patch, you can say that you did it before it was cool. Well, alright then, here's the build. Now we have an understanding of what we're building towards, and it surprisingly affects how we fundamentally use our spells. I mean, they haven't changed, right? But the scenario in which we're using them definitely has. Swashbuckle's picked up first. It's our 1000 range terrain-defying blink escape. It's a little important. Vector targeting, which this has, just so we all know, works by setting the jump to location on key press, and the aim direction from that location on mouse click down. So, while the click is down, you move the mouse the angle you want to fire, and then release, which casts the spell. The two-step process, mixed with a 1000 cast and slash range, means that you can do things like blink 1000 units away from a pursuing enemy, and at the same time, fire back on that enemy. You can double both up and fire the same direction you're jumping, effectively letting you hit units 2000 units away, and it helps jump over terrain. The attacks you send are actual attacks, it's just your attack damage is set to the spell's damage at that level. They have True Strike, Ignore Disarms, and of course, proc any and all attack modifiers. Lifesteal, although you wouldn't really lifesteal that much. Bashes from Basher, and of course Mana Burn from Diffusal. You'd think Miona would be great for this, but it and Maelstrom have internal cooldowns to their lightnings. Also, the flavor text of the spell is, the Pangolier's blade is even nimbler than his tongue. What does that mean? Shield Crash has no cast point and literally is just a 300 damage AoE nuke. It doesn't slow or stun enemies or anything like that. It does, however, give Pango damage reduction per hero hit. Hitting 5 Meepos is 90%. Hitting 5 Meepos and then a team is... It's over 100%. You're in... I feel like at that point they should just give you health for taking damage. Generally hitting 3 gives you over 50%, which is pretty good and what we're aiming for. Crash jumps you 225 units forward, which is good for getting over cliffs. Being so short a distance, it's best to hug them before you cast, elsewise you can just do that bounce thing where it pushes you back up. If you get the 90% damage reduction, which lasts 10 seconds, and then you cast Crash again, you actually keep the 90%. It doesn't update the reduction unless it's going up. If you have 18% reduction and then get a 90% reduction, it'll increase. If you get 90 and then go back down to 18, it'll stay 90 pretty much. It has a 13 second cooldown. Seems fair for a spell this good, right? Except plot twist, our level 15 talent drops this to 2 when used during our ultimate. I think, boys and girls, we've finally found our first absolutely mandatory talent. Literally nothing could be a better alternative to this, other than perhaps a 1 second cooldown. And the fact that the other one is 30 attack speed on a hero that we're not really building attack speed on, oh, it's perfect. And yes, Crash is castable during Rolling Thunder. But first, Heart Piercer is another spell, I guess. It's just a decent proc spell which would combo with Swashbuckle. On proc, after a delay of 2 seconds, the enemy gets slowed for 50% for 5 seconds, and gets his armor set to 0. Set. So that Dragonite with 300 armor? Yeah, a 300 armor reduction. What's bizarre about this is it even sets negative armor back to 0, including Deso. Did your carry Dazzle get an entire team to negative 50 armor? Oh no, well we can fix that. Proc Heart Piercer on all of them, and they're all back to 0. That was nice of you. Oh god, Then there's Rolling Thunder. Yikes, okay, easy to learn, hard to master, or, I don't know, easy to fuck up royally, hard to learn, impossible to master? I haven't gotten that point, and I've only been playing Pango this entire month. Basically, Pango curls in a ball for 8 seconds and rolls at 600 movement speed. Constantly. He rolls in a practically straight line. You do have a slight influence on making him turn, but it's at a turn rate of 0.063. It would take him 3 seconds to literally just turn around once. Behind me is a demonstration of how many times Shadowfiend can rotate 360 in the time it takes for Pango to fail at doing it once. Channel those hours of those primary school Windows 2000 computer rooms playing pinball to good use. We have to bounce. If Pango collides with unpathable terrain, he stops for a split second and then turns around 180 degrees and goes back the way he came. This can be disastrous. Every time you roll over a hero, you stun for 1.5 seconds and knock him back 0.4 seconds, but both of those things happen sequentially, so it's a 2-second stun pretty much. You also deal 350 damage. You can stun them again, but only the exact moment the first stun ends. And so all of a sudden, we're looking at the Dota world with a new lens. And we can see places that would allow for a constant stun lock. Anywhere along the river, for example, and then you just tailor fights to happen there. Or you can just have a clockwork buddy who drops down power cogs and gives you your own Hell in the Cell match. The question then becomes, with 8 seconds of potential AoE stun, how do we make that guaranteed AoE stun? And, also, how can we squeeze the most damage out of it? And so we get Yules, specifically self-Yules, right on impact. Boom, because what you're doing doesn't cancel Rolling Thunder. You've stunned this guy for 2 seconds and dealt 350 damage. You've stunned him by colliding with him, and he hasn't been able to move on account of the stun. The knockback doesn't knock him out of the range. And on account of the Yules, you haven't moved either. So you hit him, you Yules, and the first tick that he's unstunned, he's stunned again, because you're still occupying the same space. And you're perfectly safe during it. 4 seconds immediately, 700 confirmed damage. On occasion, he'll be knocked back in such a way that he can be stunned and damaged a third time, but it's a little less than 100%. And yeah, attentive viewers might have just noticed that we just used an item and roll didn't break, which would mean that we can use another item called Town Portal Scroll and also have roll not break. You can't use Four Staff. Clarification, you can if it's self-cast, but if an enemy casts it on you while you're charging up Rolling Thunder goes on cooldown. I think this is a bug. But you can use Blink. Blink literally keeps your exact direction of movement anywhere you blink. For style points, that guy you stunned 3 times, roll through him, then blink directly behind you and him and stun him a 4th time. But that's less practical outside of a game where I'm literally commanding the enemy to stand still and be a test dummy, right? No, the strat we use involves that 2-second shield crash and the fact that it's 2 seconds any and all of the time we're in Rolling Thunder while casting it. We'll get into the combo later on, but just in advance, Swashbuckle cancels Rolling Thunder, but not Shield Crash. If airborne on Swashbuckle cast, your movement through Swashbuckle also carries the Shield Crash's damage. So if you Swashbuckle onto a person right after casting Shield Crash, you hit them with Shield Crash. And this neatly fixes the issue of not facing the right way on the final Shield Crash. If we're jumping away with them, how about we just cancel Rolling Thunder altogether and turn instantly? That'd work, right? What's great about all of that is that that, with a bit of practice, is a pretty consistent combo. It doesn't require any set of circumstances, just a hero not wanting to die, and you wanting the opposite for him. Oh, okay, alrighty. Now we have the tools and the means and the knowledge to really dominate in a unique way on a unique hero, right? So let's put it into practice. Right off the bat, as offlane, you can take the offlane rune, yours, or the enemy's. With Q, you've got a pretty good get-out-of-jail-free card. When laning, secure last hits and clip your lane rival with the same cast of Q. In skirmishes, where they're not just 100% fleeing, absolutely lead with Shield Crash. You gain nothing from doing it at the end, and you directly benefit from entering a clash where you take less damage than the enemy deals. With your high mobility, you can pretty easily snag both bounties as they spawn. If their support tries to stop you, kill him. You might find you're lacking damage, or slow, perhaps. That's fine, pick up a Quelling Blade or Orb of Venom if you really think you have to, but I'd suggest against it because at level 6 you've counteracted not having a slow by simply having a spell that makes you faster than the opponent, which in essence is the point of a slow, right? Now, the next step is play 20 games, and then watch the rest of the guide. That's a step in learning this guy. I can't teach it, man. The roll and the vector targeting and the shield crash ranges, all of that, it's just something you have to fail at consistently before you can become good at it. But for everything else, I'm currently panning over the absolute best places to have to rumble. Learn the map. With every Rolling Thunder cast, your primary concern is finding a wall to bounce off of. Anything else is secondary. The absolute best place to have a fight, right here in the middle of the middle of the map. And coincidentally, a lot of fights tend to happen there. So, rejoice. Bounce from one corner to the other corner, stun lock indefinitely. Keep in mind that Shield Crash actually screws you over when you're trying to hit a wall, so you can't actually use both in some tighter areas. Here's the circumference of the circle Pango makes. Just overlay it on parts of the map, and there you go. Stun lock capitals. I'll let Sumail show you my favorite one.
What a fucking joke.
When teamfights start to form, try your best to lead in from a concealed angle. Considering you were leading with Shield Crash anyway, the best places are usually high ground, whereupon you can jump down and into range, right? If you have Yules, this is where you use it. If you have the 2-second cooldown on Shield Crash, this is where you use it. Roll into fights, Shield Crash into everyone, Yules yourself while you're colliding with as many enemies as possible, then W as soon as you get down. If you do it fast enough, the dropdown from Yules is ever so slightly before Rolling Thunder picks up again and starts you moving, so when you Shield Crash, you literally just go up and then down, which is perfect because you're already in position to be hitting everyone, right? Then try for a bounce if you can, but ultimately end with one final Shield Crash plus instant swashbuckle combo. And because technically that last crash we cast was while we were in the ball, we still have the 2-second cooldown, so 2 seconds later, cast it again. In all of this time, over 10 seconds, we have been completely magic immune from roll, then up to 90% resistant to all damage, then 100% immune to anything because of the Yules, and then constantly 90% resistance until 10 seconds after the last cast of Crash. We've just dealt about 5,000 damage each, even more with Radiance, and the one thing we didn't do was attack a single time. In fact, because of the nature of Swash cancelling roll, we actively avoid using it, which is weird, right? Because Pango, as he is right now, is being built around Swash. Really makes you think, eh? But, I don't know, maybe this is all just irrelevant. The greatest thing about Pangolier, the thing that he can do that we all wish we could do too, he can escape Dota. Look at him go. He's free from this pain. Look at him get up. They snapped him back. I guess we're all trapped. Hello. You've just gotten to the end of the Dark Willow Guide, or the Pangolier Guide. For the Dark Willow Guide, I'm sorry I got so salty. For the Pangolier Guide, I'm sorry I didn't get salty enough. Regardless of whichever one you viewed, I'd like to thank these people who made it happen. And yes, that means I'm using the same recording twice. How lazy, right? Alright. Thank you to Chris, Sir1996, Freekill, Foxy or Fucking Loxley, Lucas Gacon, Mine Siege Towers, Mr. Magic aka The Tones, Shadow Sweetheart, Jeff Miller, Mr. Revolute, I'm Pickle Rick, haha, I saw these guides a whole day ago, Ashen Rabbit, Kim Nelson, Rhett Mitchell, Leonard, Christian Rudder, Rugu Mifleur, Tsunami Shadow, Yabus McGee, English Breakfast Tea, 14, Shiva's Guard, Slap a Leg of Lamb on the Side for It, Tugs McBoat, Milocot, XD, Exato, Apache Mari wearing a headwear, neckwear, nicknamed as Hatcrafter, Jim Bob the Son of God, Soronok, Puneeth P, Scar, Grumman, the Chocotoo, Average Soul, Sandor, Sindor, I said it right once, okay. Raphael Silver, Procrastination Studios, Carbon Bond, Orange Filter Sky, I Lie About My Love for Big Butt, Neutral Platonic Land-Based Vertebrate, Raymond Horn, Freed of Londor, Ryan Webb, Emmy Dies Alone, King Gizzard and the Sheedy Wizard, Jelly Jew Giant, Pro S, Digital Dark, Hi, I'm Eric, and I'm a filthy fucking Slark First Picker. And the rest. All right, bye.